Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Of course, today we are going to continue from where we stopped. And today, we are going to look at a very interesting topic. Today is going to be lecture 4 for this second semester. Mind you are expected to pay attention and follow accordingly as expected. Now, we have a very interesting topic to treat today, and that topic is titled Poverty, Inequality, and Injustice. Wow, what a very interesting topic. Poverty, inequality, and injustice. But then, let me take you through what we'll be treating under this topic. We are going to look at the background, We are going to look at the background of the topic. Concept of poverty, that means you need to understand what poverty is because it has a lot of explanations. Various scholars have given a lot of opinions with regard to the concept of poverty. We're going to look at types of poverty. There are many, but we're going to look at the main ones and try to see how best we can relate them to Sierra Leone. Types of poverty, causes of poverty. What are the causes of poverty? People have been asking if poverty is caused by this. Well, today we're going to examine, and as social workers, our interest is to understand, to identify problems. And as we identify problems, we need to move fast, we lose some of those problems. So therefore, we're going to understand poverty, causes of poverty, and we're going to look at the concept of inequality. And in looking at the concept of inequality, we are going to look at the forms of inequality, we are going to look at the concept of injustice, forms of injustice, and after that, we now combine the two topics and look at the effect, theoretical perspective in relation to the subject matter. And finally, we cannot deal this topic as social workers without providing solutions, without giving out solutions that will solve the problem of poverty, inequality, and injustice. So this is going to be a conceptual framework that will take us through, or an outline that will take us through what we are going to do today as we proceed. Now, let's look at the background of the topic. When you say poverty, when you say inequality, and when you say injustice, these are considered as the three enemies of mankind. However, it is visible to the blind and audible to the deaf that any society that experiences poverty, inequality, and injustice is considered as a backward society. That one is not a secret. That one, you don't need a prophet to check it. But rather, it is visible to the blind and audible to the deaf. And that is why I mostly say that these concepts are linked one way or the other, because one leads to the other. Wherever poverty is, you can see inequality, you can see injustice. Wherever inequality is, you can see poverty. So a lot of these things are interlinked. And the three concepts are characteristics of what? A backward society. What am I saying here? Sierra Leone is not an exception. Being a third world country and one of the poorest countries of the world, Sierra Leone is considered as a backward society. Several scholars have made various opinions with regard to these three concepts. However, according to Professor Dr. Sears, he and various other scholars, they uphold, maintain, and defend the view that if you want to know a poor society, if you want to know a developed society, if you want to know whether this country or this society is a developed society, you need to look at these three indicators. What are these indicators? We look at what? Poverty. Whether the country that we are talking about, whether the society that we are talking about since independence, is poverty at the increase or has it decreased? Inequality, is it at the increase or has it decreased? Unemployment, is it at the decrease or has it increased? So if the answers to these questions are in the affirmative, that means they are at the decrease. Definitely, that society is considered a developed society. But taking Sierra Leone as a case study, poverty since independence has always been at the increase. Inequality, of course, has gone to a very high level. Unemployment is not something to talk about, which tells us that indeed, these three evils of mankind, poverty, inequality, injustice, etc., are things that actually have made us backward society. And according to Nelson Mandela, let's look at what Nelson Mandela said. He once asserted, as long as poverty, injustice, and gross inequality exist in our world, none of us can truly rest. None of us can. Look at what he said. Nelson Mandela was very wise when he said, inasmuch as long as poverty, as long as inequality, as long as these three things are together, Nelson Mandela is of the view that none of us can ever rest. And indeed, it is true. We'll continue to suffer, we'll continue to struggle, we'll continue to fight in development, and Mandela was one of those who supported Mandela's view in this. Let's look at the concept of poverty. But of course, it has a lot of definitions. And it can mean different, it can have different meanings for different people depending on the setting, depending on the area, depending on the context of their society. However, we now say poverty, the state of one who lacks the usual socially acceptable amount of money or material possessions. Poverty is said to exist when people lack the means to satisfy their basic needs. Whenever you lack the means that can make you satisfy your basic needs, such as food, clothing, shelter, etc., and many other, that is considered poverty to people. However, it's not a... Look at how I define poverty. I define poverty as a chronic and debilitating condition that results from multiple adverse synergistic risk factors that affect the mind, body, and soul. However you define it, poverty is complex, it does not mean the same thing for all people. What am I saying here? I am trying to say that poverty is a chronic. It is something that is so, unacceptable in society. It is so bad to the extent that it covers a lot of factors which are going to examine as we proceed in this lecture. But then these factors causing poverty are not favorable to mankind. They can reduce your morale. They can contribute to backwardness. They can lead an individual to commit suicide. They can lead... Indeed, poverty is the worst enemy of mankind. You know, now look at what Nelson Mandela said. He also asserted, overcoming poverty is not a gesture of charity. It is the protection of a fundamental human right, the right to dignity and a decent life. What was Nelson Mandela saying when he mentioned that? Mandela was saying that for us to fight poverty, it is not like we are trying to do charity to the poor. No, we are trying to protect, maintain, and defend the fundamental human right. Because poverty to one, poverty to many, is a violation of the fundamental principles. And as social workers, we must stand to uphold, we must stand to protect, we must stand to ensure that we reduce, to advocate for the less privileged in a way that can make us fight this enemy of man, which is poverty. That is why most NGOs, most social workers, humanitarian activists are concerned about poverty. Because poverty is one thing that can create underdevelopment. It's one factor that is responsible for what we are suffering today as a nation. Therefore, we have to fight it as social workers. That is why we are treating this topic, and as we progress, we are going to have a wide range of knowledge on how to attack the issue of poverty. Let us progress. Now we go to the types of poverty. We cannot treat poverty without looking at the types of poverty. Types of poverty are many, depending on the society. Depending. But for the sake of this lecture, mind you, what I am doing at this level is to lay a platform, is to create an agenda that will give you an advanced knowledge on the topic of on the concept of poverty, inequality, and injustice. So that as you progress the academic ladder in your study of the concept of social work, you will not be able to understand how to, you will not have got the armor, the academic fortification to actually target poverty. And when you come down to the universe, you will be a qualified individual to fight poverty as an enemy of mankind. One poverty that we're going to deal with is situational poverty. What is situational poverty? It generally occurs by a sudden crisis or loss and is often temporary. Events causing situational poverty include environmental disaster, divorce, or severe health problems. What am I saying here? That is why I've progressed in the concept of the study of social work. We're going to teach what we call disaster management, risk management. These are unfortunate circumstances, emergency circumstances, emergency situations that arise unexpectedly. And when they arise, whenever they visit mankind, they are bound to cause situational poverty. For example, the mudslide that occurred in Sierra Leone. Oh yes, the Ebola virus disease that occurred in Sierra Leone. The current coronavirus that is currently ravaging the country. Now, whenever this disaster occur, whenever circumstances such as drought, flooding, etc. occur, they are bound to
reduce people to nothingness. People will lose properties, money will go, houses will be destroyed, and when that happens, people for that moment will be result of poverty. That poverty may be temporary because it is possible some people may get aid from somewhere else. It is possible some people are educated, they can get a job and recover. It is possible some people can easily get a lot of other assistance, so it is temporary. Others have suffered a lot based on situational poverty. Another type of poverty is generational poverty. When I mention generational poverty, somebody may say, what is it going to say? You know, this is what is affecting Africa. You know, most people have been poor since Adam was born. Others have been poor since the generation. Imagine, since the days of your forefathers, they were glorifying poverty. Your father came, he was also glorifying poverty. And he also came, he wants to glorify poverty. That is the generational poverty. What is generational poverty? It occurs in families where at least two generations have been born into poverty. Families living in this type of poverty are not equipped with the tools to move out of their situations. They cannot move. They cannot progress. They cannot. They have no. In fact, they are not educated. Some of them are not educated. Some of them do not have somebody who can actually push them further. That is a problem. But however, I have a message for you. Dennis Atah was asserted, and I quote, "Your background should not be the reason why your back is on the ground." What am I saying here? Your back, that you are poor. You came from a poor background does not mean that your back should be on the ground. Does not mean that you should continue to be poor. Does not mean that you will continue to be bad. Does not mean that you are you're going to accept the situation. However, when you are poor, the poverty you suffer from is your responsibility to a certain extent. But we are coming, I don't want to move. I don't want to take you. As I progress, you are going to learn. Do not accept generational poverty as social workers. Because we can contain, we can limit it, we can prevent it. But as we progress, we're going to understand. Absolute poverty is another type of poverty we're going to deal with. What is absolute poverty? And what is visible in Sierra Leone? Of course, it is very visible. That one, even the blind, it is visible to the blind and audible to the deaf. Absolute poverty, of course, is in Sierra Leone. It involves a scarcity of short necessities, a shelter, running water, food. Families who live in absolute poverty tend to focus on day-to-day survival. Some scholars may say that absolute poverty is also referred to as extreme poverty. That is the worst form of poverty in which one survives from remnants, dilapidated houses, or market tables, under bridges, etc. What am I saying here? People who suffer from absolute poverty cannot get their basic needs on their own. They do not have food, shelter, and clothing. That is why some scholars have said that absolute poverty is also referred to as extreme poverty, the last category of poverty. That is the poorest of the poor, of the poor. An individual cannot be able to get what they do. Now, some people, they go to the dustbin to pick remnants. When people eat, they give them. That is how they survive. Others, what do? They will have to go to bed for clothing. Others sleep under bridges. Others on top of marketing. Now, how? We, social workers, are the only solution to these problems. We are the ones that can create policies. We are the ones that can advocate for better lives. And the best thing to do is to solve the problem of poverty, which is what? Absolute poverty. But we are coming here. Relative poverty is another type of poverty that is living. It refers to economic status of a family whose income is insufficient to meet society's average standard of living. For example, 3 years ago, they could say, if you know, you cannot live above $1 a day, you are a poor person. You are relatively poor, comparatively. So you see, and how many Sierra Leoneans do live above $1 a day? That one is very important, but we are going to examine that as we progress. See, of course, let's progress. Urban poverty. We have urban and we have rural poverty. You know, even in urban areas, there are poor people. Now we say, urban poverty occurs in metropolitan areas with population of at least 50,000 people. The urban poor deal with what complex aggregate of chronic and acute stressors, including poverty. You see, in certain parts of this country, like the Kube, the Mwaf, and other areas, like I cannot be able to live on. But we all know as Sierra Leoneans that. Imagine 15 people sleeping in a single room in the city. That is urban poverty. Imagine the life that they are living. They cannot feed them. They cannot.
Oh my goodness, that is very much. And then, you know, that is why sociologists are interested now in studying urban sociology, which gives them a roadmap or to understand, understanding urban problems and how to target these urban problems. Social workers are also interested in that same. And we have rural sociologists who are also interested in knowing the problems of the rural people and understanding how to really solve the problem of these rural poor. Now, social workers, whether we decide to work in rural areas, whether we decide to work in urban areas, our interest is to solve societal problems, problems affecting mankind. Now, we also have a form of collective poverty. This is very interesting. We said it's relatively general and lasting in parts of Asia, the Middle East, most of Africa, and parts of South Africa, and Central America. I'm telling you, most of these areas I'm calling are third world countries. Africa, third world countries. Now, we look at Asia, most of these areas are poor. And they suffer from collective poverty. We are most of the social aspect of life are not given to them. They have no lifespan. They have a poor feeling nutritional, you know, concession. They have a lot of other problems. Their health sector is not developed. Education is poor. Sierra Leone is a case study. Where are we here? Our life expectancy can be 54 years. If I told in 2020, 54 years. And if you live above 54 years, glory be to the Almighty. Because you can have any time. Now, you go to certain parts of Asia, they are lucky, maybe 71 years with their life expectancy for 2020. You begin to see how really poor some of these countries are. A man like me who is not ready to die, thinking of living a life because of the situation that we have. Why? Collectively, we do not have good healthcare. We do not have better education system. We do not have better medical facility. We do not have good food. We do not have most of the when the people in general do not have the basic fundamental needs, the things that can make life comfortable for them. Collectively, they are poor. And as a country, even if we have real people here, because the majority are poor, we are collectively poor as a nation. So we have to think about it. Let us progress. Let's look at the causes of poverty. If we say we're going to discuss what causes poverty as social workers, we will not be able to stop. That is why, for any society we go, try to examine the causes of poverty. There are many. I'm going to use Sierra Leone. As I'm putting my lectures together, I'm using Sierra Leone as a case study, and Africa as a whole. What are the causes of poverty in Africa and Sierra Leone to be specific? Inequality and injustice. Most parts of the world, as they are experiencing poverty as a result of inequality. The rich get richer and the poor get poorer. That is inequality. No fairness in life, injustice. That is it. I can't escape the problem to the extent that the rich suppresses the poor so that the poor cannot grow. And we see that the man who is the managing director is receiving 15 to 20 million euros doing nothing for actually sitting down. And why the man who a lot of problems have occurred in Africa, the person who is the secretary who does all the work will receive 500,000? Is that equality? That is inequality. That is injustice. And that has been one of the factors contributing to poverty in Africa and Sierra Leone to be specific. We begin to see as we explore some of these concepts, we begin to realize why Africa is poor. Why Asia? Why Sierra Leone? Conflict. When we begin to fight ourselves, properties are going to be destroyed. Businessmen will lose their money. Some people will become poor, and conflict, not only in Sierra Leone, but across the world, is responsible for poverty. And has always been responsible. For example, during the 11-year senseless civil war in Sierra Leone, most people lost their jobs. Others have to go as refugees. Some people became poor, even though some viewed it as an opportunity to get rich. But conflict can result to poverty. Illiteracy, of course, Sierra Leoneans are always poor. We have one of the highest amounts of illiteracy rate in Africa. And of course, we realize that illiteracy is also contributing to poverty. Because when a person lacks the basic skills to actually do the required job, the person cannot get employment. And when the individual lacks employment, the person cannot get a salary. And lack of salary or allowance or wages or whatever can result to poverty. So a lot of problems. bad governance, of course. Our politicians since independence, most of our politicians, let me not be categorical. Let me be specific somehow. Now, most of our politicians since independence have always engaged in corruption. Some of them are always selfish. They come to power to satisfy their greed. I like an African poet, a Nigerian to be specific, Philip Obioma Chinedu, when he was analyzing his poem Ambassador to the Poverty. You may actually describe in that poem how bad governance contributes to poverty, how the ambassadors, how these politicians have been wrecking the economy of these nations and of Africa and Nigeria to be specific. You may, in his poem Ambassadors of Poverty, actually mention, he said, ambassadors of poverty are the corrupt masters of the economy with their heads in abroad and in us at home. Most of these people, when they come to governance, their investment is done in abroad. They forget about us. They claim to be serious. They claim to be meticulous, but they are wrecking our economy to satisfy their brothers and sisters at home. They are wrecking our economy to do investment in abroad. They don't even invest, and that is bad governance. He did not stop there. Look at what he also said. He said, "Bet not in reverse order the determined matter of loot, who boosts the economy of the colonial border to impoverish their brothers and sisters at home." He said, "They are the seekers of these loafers in guests of workers, bearers of incompetent kleptomaniac figures, and something filament." When he was analyzing, Yume was very categorical, he was very specific, he was very emphatic on the point that these guys are contributing to poverty in such a way that they are responsible for the backwardness of our nation and contributing to the poorness of all the people. So a lot of things, but as we progress, we will examine lack of employment facilities, that one we discussed, corruption and also nature. So all these things contribute to our poverty and many more that we cannot discuss now. Let us progress. Of course, the effect of poverty. When a country or a nation is poor, what are the effects? There are many, but I have managed to highlight few of them. And as we discuss in our question and answer sessions, we will not be able to dive more into the effect of poverty. Starvation and eventually death. When a country is poor or a nation is poor, it experiences a lot of starvation. People are going to starve because there is no food to eat. Even those who eat are going to get malnourished. And we don't eat nutrients, a lot of things. And oh my goodness, that is why Koshioka Marasmus is mostly in Africa, Sierra Leone to be specific. So starvation, acute and chronic stressors or psychological problems, disorders are going to be the problem. We still realize that in Africa, or even Sierra Leone officials, a lot of psychological disorders have arose, mental issues are coming up. Now we have experiencing schizophrenia, people are experiencing schizoaffective disorder, others are experiencing a lot of disorders, bipolar. So what do you think are the causes? Others have been stressed, others are psychologically traumatized, and that trauma has led to a lot of other problems, and these problems have made people mad. Is it mental health can no longer accommodate most of the mad people across the country? Why? Because of poverty. Some of them, it is because of poverty. They walk along the streets traumatized. This leads to a lot of other problems. And you know, that is why we have psychological problems in Africa. And Sierra Leone is not an exception. So we need to see as social workers. We are getting a lot of social problems. And these social problems are leading, are calling for immediate remedies, solutions. And you are the only solution to those problems. To ensure that you engage in social support, you engage in advocacy to solve these problems affecting Africa as a whole. Now, high crime rate, when there is poverty, people engage in armed robbery. When there is poverty, people engage in gambling. When there is poverty, a lot of other problems will come. So it is in fact a recipe for high crime rates. And that is why, if we want to control high crime rates in Africa, we suggest that we have to ensure that poverty is reduced to a very high level so that we can be able to. Prostitution. Our sisters these days are going to prostitution because they lie. Some of them, in fact, it is their parents. They cannot feed them. They cannot pay their school fee. They cannot be responsible at college level. So they will have to fend for themselves. And in doing so, prostitution, which is also another social problem bringing a lot of harm, like HIV. You know, this is something that is. And social workers must take notes. Of course, drug abuse. Some people, because they are traumatized or because of poverty, the best thing they can do is to offend drugs. Some others have resorted to taking Tramadol. Recently, jazz or pampas drugs, as it is commonly called, you know, in Sierra Leone. So we begin to realize how many people offend God. Some of them, it is because they are stressed. And they see the only solution is to offend God. Deviants. People tend to deviate from societal norms. Why? Because they are poor. And when some people are poor, they want to survive. The best thing is to deviate from the laws, the norms of society, so that they can be able to survive. Illiteracy is also eminent because people, some people, because of their background, because of their family background, they cannot be able to go to school, they cannot be able, others who manage to go to school cannot get college degrees, they end up becoming poor. All these are serious issues. Let's look at social inequality. Well, inequality in a commonsensical thought can always mean not being equal. We are not the same, one person being above the other, etc. Social inequality occurs when resources in a given society are distributed unevenly, typically through norms of allocation that encompasses specific patterns along lines of social, usually defined categories of persons. It is the differentiation preference of access to social goods in society brought about by power, religion, prestige, race, ethnicity, gender. We now see that inequality is very, very heavy. We have been discussing throughout. And as we discuss about social inequality, we see that in certain societies, resources are distributed unevenly. They are not distributed equally. What is supposed to be distributed to a specific group of people is not done. Some people are prioritized. Others are given because of certain reasons. So when that happens, inequality comes in. Because of one reason or the other, one region is the priority. Because of one reason or the other, one tribe is the priority. Because of one reason or the other, certain group of people are priorities. Because of one reason, when that happens, we begin to get what? Inequality evident in society. Let us progress. Now let's see what happens. We see, let's look at the brief highlight from fascism. We are not going deep, definitely we are not going deep, because I'm just giving a background of the lecture. As you progress to second year or more, you are going to get a lot of other concepts on fascism. Now, of course, two key scholars have made their opinions. Just briefly, what is Karl Marx saying? When I read about capitalism, I realized that various scholars have defined capitalism. But however, capitalism is referred to as a political system or an economic system in which most of the means of production and distribution are owned and controlled by private individuals, in which the activities of the government is at a minimum. Here, private individuals have the right to decide on what to produce, where to produce, where to produce, and the distribution of what has been produced. Private individuals are the head of affairs, and for Karl Marx, there has always been a problem between two categories of people who are unequal. When we are talking about fascism, and here we are going to look at inequality briefly. And Karl Marx is always saying that the conflict arose from between two sets of individuals. Who are these individuals? We are the bourgeoisies, who claim they are the capitalists, who claim that they are the richer, who claim that they are the powerful men, they are the businessmen, they are the tycoons, and the politicians. We are individuals who are poor. They sell their labor for wages. They are employed by the capitalists. And in capitalism, what do we experience? The rich get richer, and the poor get poorer. And here, Karl Marx has always emphasized. So now let's see what happened. For Karl Marx, there exist two major social classes with significant inequality between the two. You see that? There are two major classes. Right? The two are delineated by their relationship to the means of production in a given society. Those two classes are defined as the owners of the means of production that we are talking about capitalists here, the owners of the means of production. You see that? And those who sell their labor, that is the proletarians, the poor. You see that? So we see that we have the bourgeoisies, the rich, the poor. So these two people are always in conflict. And the rich suppresses the poor. And Karl Marx has a lot to say about it as we progress in academic life. Marx said, I use these social classes to examine wealth and status. Of course, for Marx Weber, he has always been interested in examining using social classes to talk about wealth, to talk about status. For him, social class is strongly associated with prestige.